Hello, this is Lazarus at telecomTech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining the configuration of OSPF version 3 using address families. If you want to configure an OSPF topology that has both IPv4 and IPv6 addresses, one option you can use is to run two separate instances of OSPF, one using OSPF version 2 for IPv4 and one using OSPF version 3 for IPv6. However, OSPF version 3 has the capability of implementing address families, which allows you to share both IPv4 and IPv6 networks using the same OSPF version 3 instance. There's just one catch here. OSPF version 3 supports only IPv6 OSPF adjacencies. In other words, the interfaces serving the OSPF adjacencies must be configured with IPv6. As we saw in the previous video, this is achieved using link local IPv6 addresses. So in this video, we'll be creating a topology where we will advertise both IPv4 and IPv6 networks between two routers running OSPF version 3. This will be quite interesting because it highlights the way that OSPF version 3 functions in the presence of both IPv4 and IPv6 address spaces. And this is what is known as a dual stack scenario, where both IPv4 and IPv6 protocol stacks are in use. Now, this is the topology that we'll be looking at. Here we have R2 with a loopback 0 interface assigned an IPv6 address, and loopback 1 assigned an IPv4 address. We'll create an OSPF version 3 adjacency between R1 and R2, such that R1 will have both of these networks in its corresponding IPv4 and IPv6 routing tables. Let's start by configuring IPv6 in both of our routers. Let's start with R1. Remember, OSPF version 3 is natively an IPv6 based protocol, so it needs the underlying IPv6 functionality to operate correctly. We start by enabling the operation of IPv6 globally on the router like so. Next, we issue the router OSPF version 3 1 command. Now note that this command is different than the IPv6 router OSPF 1 command, which we used in the previous video. That command enables OSPF version 3 only for IPv6, where address families cannot be used. We need to issue this command here so address families can be configured. Then we configure the router ID like so. So once we issue these commands, OSPF is now running, but it's not enabled for IPv4 or IPv6 specifically. That has to be done with the address family commands here. With these commands, you enable OSPF version 3 for both IPv4 and IPv6. Notice that you enter the router address family configuration mode when you issue that command. In that command mode, you have the option of issuing various additional commands that have to do with fine-tuning OSPF for that particular address family. For now, we won't use any of these commands. It's simply enough to have enabled OSPF version 3 for both IPv4 and IPv6. Next, we perform exactly the same commands on R2 as well. Now, R1 and R2 have IPv6 enabled and have OSPF version 3 running, and have both IPv4 and IPv6 address families participating in OSPF. We haven't yet configured any interfaces or IP addresses. Let's do that now. Let's start with the loopback 0 interface on R2. We go in and create the loopback interface and assign an IPv6 address to it like so. Remember, when you assign an IPv6 address, IPv6 is automatically enabled on that interface itself. Then you issue this command here. It tells the router that the interface will participate in the OSPF version 3 process with process ID 1 using the IPv6 address family. The interface is assigned to area 0. This means that the associated IPv6 address space of the interface will now be advertised using OSPF version 3. Now let's configure our loopback WAN interface with an IPv4 address space. Now here we see something interesting. We create our loopback interface and assign it an IPv4 address as normal. Then we issue the OSPF version 3 1 IPv4 area 0 command. This command tells the router that this interface will participate in OSPF version 3 with process ID of 1 using the IPv4 address family, and the interface will be placed in area 0. This should tell the router that the associated subnet with this interface will be advertised using OSPF version 3. But there's a problem. It won't let us do that because IPv6 is not enabled on this interface. But why? The interface just has an IPv4 address. The reason is because OSPF version 3 functions natively within an IPv6 environment. So even interfaces using IPv4 addresses must be at least enabled for IPv6 in order for them to participate. You don't have to assign an IPv6 address, but IPv6 should be enabled. So we enable it using this command, and then we issue the OSPF version 3 command again, and we see that it is accepted. So now this IPv6 network and this IPv4 subnet are being advertised using OSPF version 3, but we don't yet have an OSPF adjacency. Let's configure that now. Here we see for both R1 and R2, we have the same configuration. We must go into the Gigabit Ethernet 01 interface and enable IPv6. We don't need to assign an IPv6 address since link local addresses will be assigned automatically and will be used for the OSPF version 3 adjacency. Remember, OSPF version 3 can share IPv4 address spaces, but the OSPF adjacencies must be based on an IPv6 communication. Now, in order for R1 to be able to reach the loopback 1 interface, we must also assign IPv4 addresses to the Gigabit Ethernet interfaces. This isn't actually part of the OSPF configuration, but it is part of the underlying network topology needed to enable connectivity. So on both R1 and R2, we must assign IPv4 addresses on these physical Gigabit Ethernet interfaces like so. This doesn't cancel out the IPv6 connectivity we have here. We just enable IPv4 as well between these two routers simultaneously. Then we enable OSPF version 3 on these interfaces for both the IPv4 and the IPv6 address families like so. This will allow the neighbor adjacencies to exchange IP addresses of both address families. But remember, the exchange only takes place over the IPv6 connection between the two routers. Once that's done, we should be finished with our OSPF version 3 configuration. Let's take a look at the results of what we've done. With this command here, we can take a look at the OSPF version 3 neighbor adjacencies. Here we can see the neighbor adjacencies that have been created, and we can see a neighbor for the IPv4 address family and another neighbor for the IPv6 address family. The neighbor is the same, however, two adjacencies are created, one for each address family. So each neighbor adjacency is responsible for advertising and exchanging the address spaces within each address family. For each of these, you can see details such as neighbor IDs, adjacency states, and the DR and BDR statuses. So for both address families, we see successful neighbor relationships. Now let's take a look at our IPv4 and IPv6 routing tables in our R1 router. Even though we're using a single instance of OSPF version 3, the router still maintains separate routing tables for each address family. In our IPv4 routing table, we see that this network was learned, and we have a next hop IP address of 10.10.10.2, which is the IPv4 address assigned to the Gigabit Ethernet 01 interface of R2. So that looks good as our next hop. Now let's take a look at our IPv6 routing table. Here you can see that in R1, we have an IPv6 route to this network here in R2, and the next hop IP is the IPv6 link local address of our Gigabit Ethernet 01 interface of R2. So it looks like we've successfully used OSPF version 3 to advertise both IPv4 and IPv6 routes between these two routers using the address families feature of the protocol. If you found this video useful, I would like to ask that you consider using the YouTube Super Thanks feature to say thank you and support my effort to simply explain telecom and networking. As I'm always striving to improve my videos, the funds will be used to support better equipment, better quality, better video editing services, and just to produce more useful training content. As always, check out my website where very soon you'll be able to find in-depth courses with labs, quizzes, and exams to test your knowledge and prepare you for certifications, as well as for the real-world networking and telecom industry. I'm always adding more courses and content to that site. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at telecomTech. I hope this has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.